welcome to this episode of The Farmer Files. Now that we have finished our study on La Llorona, we will be looking at the phenomenon of the shadow people. I wasn't able to find a whole lot of information on this phenomenon, interestingly. It seems that while there are many people who report seeing shadows, there hasn't been a lot of credible research into it. I looked in several cultures, including Celtic, Norse, Native American, and Japanese, for anything similar to shadow people, shadow walkers, night walkers, etc. However, I came up with very little. It seems this is a rather modern phenomenon with little cultural roots. The majority of what cultural evidence does exist stems from Native American traditions, so that is what we will be discussing today. Firstly, however, we must look at the modern-day phenomenon and what it actually is. The Shadow People phenomenon first officially received the title of Shadow People on Coast to Coast AM during an interview with Heidi Hollis. She would go on to publish several books on her encounters, including The Secret War, The Heavens Speak of the Battle in 2001. This book is now out of print, replaced with the new version, The Secret War, A True Story About a Real Alien War and Shadow People, put out in 2014. She is considered to be the leading expert on the current Shadow People phenomenon, having labeled several different types of phenomenon. While I have been unable to get her book, I will be doing so in the future, and I will talk to Derek about I already have spoke to Derek, and we will be doing a special in the future about what the book actually says. Based on the description of the book, reviews, and information on her website, it appears that she believes these shadow beings are actual demons. She also apparently believes that they are separate entities from aliens, but that some aliens do appear as hooded, extremely short, or extremely tall, shadowed figures. It also appears that she believes the aliens to be neutral intermediaries. The description of her book is as follows, slightly truncated, but in 1997, Hollis gave this dark presence their name. Now she stands as the world's foremost expert. She was once besieged by ghosts, poltergeist, then witnessed UFOs, only to have the alien occupants come in for a closer look. Hollis soon discovers that there is an ancient war brewing in our skies and in the homes of individuals around the world, including her own. With horror surrounding Hollis and a college roommate on a daily basis, they are both given the tools to defend themselves against this dark menace. This help came to them by the way of a being who is already engaged in this secret war, an alien who claimed to be watching this battle between good and evil. Unquote. In her original book, The Heavens Speak of the Battle, she also discussed Christianity, Stonehenge, crop circles, the Giza pyramids, cryptozoology, and other esoteric and mysterious things. I do not know if the new version speaks on these, and the original is no longer available for purchase. According to her website, the shadow people can manifest into numerous forms, including these categories listed on her website: legless or head and shoulders only shadows, shadow clouds, shadow spheres, shadow streaks, shadow cats, shadow spiders, short hooded spiders, which she claims are really, short hooded shadows, not spiders, which she claims are really aliens and are 3 to 4 feet tall, tall hooded shadows, which are also supposedly aliens and are 6 feet tall, 6 feet tall or taller, and the Grim Reaper type. The Grim Reaper is also hooded and is over 6 feet tall, but Hollis is careful to distinguish between it and the tall hooded shadows. The Grim Reaper does hold a scythe, the tall hooded do not, and reportedly disappear in a blinding spiral of light. There is also, of course, the Hat Man, which is in a category all its own, and seems to be considered by Hollis different than the Shadow People. Many reports, by Hollis and by others, have glowing red eyes. Some reports state that they will simply stare at you. Others have reported being scratched, bitten, and even raped. I will give more information about Ms. Hollis's reports after reading the book. Right now, I have no idea how credible she is, and most of what she says seems incredibly outlandish. It looks like she's into a few things that aren't good. For example, she apparently communed with an alien that supposedly was there to help her. At one point, she even had a website where readers could ask this being questions. So I am very suspicious of her information right now. But for now, I am withholding judgment on her statements until after I read the book. So let's look at a few cultural occurrences instead and see what we can find there. Derek mentioned in his article that the Nalusochito, I probably am butchering that, but of Choctaw Indian religion. So I did a little digging into this phenomenon. Reports as to what exactly it is varies, and there's not a whole lot of information from reputable sources on the web about it. Forgive my dog moaning in the background. He's mad at me. The Choctaw Nation Historic Preservation Department puts out a newspaper, Biskinik, which answers questions and provides information about Choctaw culture. The December 2009 issue of the Itafavisa section of the newspaper briefly mentions the Nalusochito. Here, the Nalusa is described as being the Choctaw equivalent of Satan. Nalusochito is translated literally as big black thing. This, however, is not a very descriptive explanation. While big black thing could be seen as a shadow person, the term is so vague that calling it such would be postulation at best. A big black thing absolutely could describe a shadow person, but it could also describe a grizzly bear with equal plausibility. Other sources that speak on the Nalusochito state that it also goes by the name Impa Shilup, for which I was unable to find a literal translation. Shilup, however, is defined as an inner shadow or spirit, as opposed to Shilombish, or the outer shadow, which we will be discussing in a moment. The Nalusa, or Impa Shilup, is similar to the skinwalker in the fact that the Choctaw are incredibly hesitant to speak on the matter, believing that saying the name of the entity will summon it. It is believed to target individuals who are depressed or have vices such as alcoholism or addiction, attacking and possibly possessing them. Other reports state that the Nalusochito was a black shadow which would seep into one's body and devour their soul. While this does fit the shadow people phenomenon in some ways, it appears that most often the Nalusochito go completely unseen. The Shilombish referenced earlier is another possible corroborating witness to the shadow people phenomenon. The Shilombish was the outer shadow, and every being is thought by the Choctaw to have this outer shadow. The Shilombish is not allowed to enter the afterlife, Shilup Iyanki, and therefore it must wander the earth. Some sources state this is only for a few days. Others state the Shilombish is doomed to wander forever. The Shilombish are considered to be an equivalent to ghosts, but no note of how they appear is mentioned. Given it is the individual's shadow, it seems reasonable to assume that if they are visible at all, they would still be seen as shadows. A Shilombish can mimic the cry of different animals, such as the fox or the owl, in order to mock, taunt, or scare the living, according to tradition. According to this tradition, anytime an owl or fox cries, another responds in kind. However, when the Shilombish mimics these cries, there is never a responding cry, because the animals know the difference and they don't respond to it. This is how the Choctaw would recognize the difference between a normal fox or owl cry and the cry of a Shilombish. Shilombish would often hang around either the place of burial, the place of death, or the previous home of its owner, attempting to frighten others away from that area. My research did not find any incidents where Shilombish were believed to cause physical harm, or even to have the ability to harm. By attempting to mimic the cry of an owl or fox, they would attempt to scare a person, since both carry bad omens according to tradition, but this trick appears to be its only weapon. Another cultural tie that has been brought up is the Arabic jinn, usually translated in English into genie or jinni. Unlike the genie from Aladdin's lamp, the jinn of true mythology was very rarely benevolent. Wishes granted by jinn often went terribly wrong. They are described in some texts as being made of smokeless fire, which would fit the description of shadow people. However, jinn are often described as attacking individuals in the case of an encounter where they were not summoned or tied by any vows. While some people are reported as attacking... While some shadow people are reported as attacking or even raping individuals, most sightings report they simply stare or flee when spotted. This would not align well with how the jinn are said to behave. Finally, I must address another possibility that Derek proposed, which is sleep paralysis. Of all the possible explanation and cultural ties listed above, this, to me, is the least plausible. Sleep paralysis is used as a cure-all for any paranormal activity, from shadow people to abductions, often without basis. In this case, the only box which sleep paralysis checks is seeing weird things or feeling a presence in the room. The most obvious problem here is that the individuals reporting shadow people are not paralyzed. I have yet to see one example in my research where individuals reported being paralyzed in any way. In addition, many are not asleep or close to falling asleep when these incidents occur. For example, in Derek's article, he recounts Kiki's accident. Kiki was walking across a bridge when she had an encounter. She was nowhere near falling asleep. As always, the veracity of this phenomenon is up for you to decide. Personally, I am still unsure what to make of the information my research has uncovered. While in modernity the occurrence seems highly common, there is little cultural foundation that I can find that aligns with these. So this tells me that either the phenomenon is something which is artificial, created or caused by something in modernity that was not there before, or it is an entity which has only emerged recently. Going back to our very first episode, we know that electromagnetic interference can cause visual hallucinations as well as the sensing of a presence which is not actually there. Solar activity has been steadily increasing over the last several years. In fact, there were several extremely large CMEs in April 2022, this month. That's last month now. Sorry. Time flies. Twice this year alone, the radiation put off by the sun was so extreme that shortwave radio frequencies were disrupted over the Pacific Ocean and over South Africa, something practically unheard of in the past. We are constantly being bombarded by a variety of local electromagnetic waves and radiation from electronic devices and radio waves. The introduction of 5G makes this all the more severe. No matter whether you have a device near you or not, everyone is being exposed to this radiation because of the cell towers. Being near a cell tower, 5G or otherwise, or a radio tower amplifies this exposure exponentially. Bluetooth headphones and ear pods have also been shown to transmit these waves directly into the brain because it goes straight through the ear canal. So it is not out of the question that our brains are being interfered with now more than they ever have been in the past. So I will not rule this out as an explanation. However, I have made no concrete conclusions on this matter. Thank you for joining us for this investigation. I hope you will join us for our next one. Have a good day and God bless.